not only as a Pentecost, the birth of the church, but it's also First Communion Sunday. And we're very privileged and very happy to celebrate that with these two beautiful little girls. And also something quite unique today is that the father of Helena is also making his First Communion today. As we give praise to Almighty God for the love that he has for us, we give him worship and praise. If this is your first time to St. Joseph's, we give you a special welcome. We are honored to use the Maronite ritual of the Catholic faith. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever. He gave us life, and he poured the Holy Spirit upon us, the Spirit of adoption, through whom we call you our Father. With joy and holiness, make us worthy to celebrate this Pentecost Sunday, the feast of the descent of your Holy Spirit on the pure disciples in the upper room. And we thank you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children.
Thank you.
You descended in the form of tongues of fire on the holy apostles and filled them with divine gifts. Accept our incense, and in your grace, fill us with your strength, wisdom, and holiness. Show us the riches of your heavenly gifts that you bestow on each of us according to our worthiness. We raise glory and thanks to you and to the Father and to his only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, now and forever.
Amen.
Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia. Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in their own languages. We hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They're filled with fine wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon the slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved."
Praise be to God always.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory. Thanks to the word of the living God.
The Lord Jesus says, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments, and I'll ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me because I live. You also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise.
the celebration of Pentecost and the phrase, the coming of the Paraclete, is certainly the mind of a little child. When they would talk about Pentecost and the second week of Pentecost, and I thought it was Latin for Santa Claus. And the Paraclete, I thought it was Latin for parakeet. So you can see that I flunked Latin at an early age. But there's still, the true meaning is very beautiful and very wonderful. But the season of Pentecost, it means that the Holy Spirit has been brought into the world and gave the apostles courage and strength to preach the gospel. And the Holy Spirit, with one of the titles being Paraclete, means he is a comforter. He came to comfort us. In this translation of the gospel, the word advocate is being used for. He's also someone who advocates for us, that it stands before us and within us to plead our case. And all of this is linked to the commandment of love, because that is the essence of who God is, and it's what every single person who ever has existed needs most to experience in their life. And there is an infinite number of ways of expressing love, poems and cards, and kindness and compassion and forgiveness and mercy. But it all involves in some way or another that we have to obey commandments. Now, often when we are told to obey, it's used at a time when we least want to obey. I mean, how many times is a parent going to say, I command you to go to the store and spend all my money? It's just never going to happen. It's usually used when you don't want someone to do something. And in a way, that's unfortunate. Because to be disciplined and to follow commandments in the way that God intends us is to tell us how to live in order not to hurt ourselves and not to hurt others. You know that being a parent is in a perpetual state of saying no, don't touch that, don't grab a hold of grandma's earrings and all kinds of no's. And we don't like the word no. And that's very understandable, because by our very nature and who we are in God's plan for us originally was that would never need to be said, that we would instinctively already know the right thing to do, the things that would keep us from being hurt. And that's why the prayers so beautifully tell us to pray for wisdom, to pray for knowledge, to pray for understanding. And that's what the Holy Spirit is supposed to do in our life. Now, on Pentecost, it gave the apostles the ability to speak any language in which a person was listening. That if you were there and all you knew it was Arabic, you would hear them preaching Jesus in Arabic. Or if you were Greek, or if you were from Spain, Mesopotamia, wherever you're from. And that is very important for us to remember, because all of us need a message of love in our language. And I'm not necessarily just saying to know it in English or Belgian or French, but to say it in the language that your heart will open up. It is really actually quite difficult to love in the way God loves us. And the reason for that is that we are wounded, that we are hurting in some way, or we don't have accurate knowledge. Our perception of the world is distorted. that we draw conclusions that are usually exaggerated out of proportion to what actually happened. And we all experience this in growing up. We have frictions and tensions. We argue with our siblings. We argue with just about anybody who disagrees with us. And somewhere along the line, we have to form a way that we can cope as broken people, hurt people, wounded people, people who don't know everything, except for teenagers, of course, in a way that instead of going to war, we negotiate peace. You know, the apostles were scared to death because this message had brought death upon their Savior. And they wondered who was next. They had to be crushed. They were still running and reeling with their betrayal. Judas hanging himself, horrified. How do you love under conditions like that? And yet the Holy Spirit rested upon them and gave them hope and courage and strength, and were able to do things that they could never even imagine they would ever have the courage to do. But what about me? What about you? There are things that happen to us in life that can shame us beyond comprehension. Just think of the shame that Peter must have had, promising all those promises and then running scared. How about the times when people have said things and they didn't know it pertained to you, and you realize that actually if they knew the real you, they would hate you. And yet you have to find ways to survive in that atmosphere. What kind of fears are there between spouses? What kind of fears are there between children that if they ever found out, their parents ever found out something, they are completely convinced they could not possibly be loved? And what about ourselves? How many turn to destructive behaviors, risk-taking, self-medication, you name it, to try to feel love? The problem is that as long as we are hiding, as long as we have to fake, as long as we are not dealing with the wounds that we have within us, no amount of affirmation will work. And so we come to the Holy Spirit. I remember reading for the first time where Paul writes, the Holy Spirit is like a two-edged sword slicing between muscle and bone. And I thought, I don't really like that imagery whatsoever. That would really hurt. And yet, the Holy Spirit isn't talking about causing a hurt within us. But for God's desire to be sharp enough, loving enough, forgiving enough, compassionate, comforting enough, that if it reached the point where you hurt the most, you would find healing. You know, originally we would know everything about God, everything about what is good in the world, just by walking with Him in the coolness of the evening, as we find in Genesis. But it's obvious that that's not true now. However you want to amplify the simple message of Adam and Eve, it still holds the most profound in the most deepest understanding of our humanity. We have made a mistake. We have rebelled. We have tried to follow our own reasoning at times when the reasoning of God would have been far more richer and profound and protective. And now the Holy Spirit is given to us, that even maybe we can't get rid of all the scars of life, we can begin to work on the healing, to let him in to the deepest part. You know, not every wound is necessarily identifiable as personal sin, but things do go wrong that are outside of our control. And yet sometimes we take on responsibilities that don't belong to us. It's just simply a rebellious world. But I offer to you, as I offer to myself, the spirit of truth, that the more truthful we can be with God, the more we can allow our vulnerabilities to be present in his eye, it allows us to see ourselves in the beauty in which God sees. And it doesn't take billions of dollars of cosmetics to be acceptable to the loving gaze of the Heavenly Father. It just takes us being truthful. We once upon a time, and the plan was we never needed redemption because nothing bad had happened yet. But now we need it. Today, First Holy Communion Day, the Holy Spirit will come down upon the bread and the wine. And it will transform this bread and transform this wine through the power of the Holy Spirit. And I think these symbols are very powerful because in some ways, these things give us life in the natural world, but now it gives us life in the spiritual world. And the interesting thing and the profound thing about this is that it's all done because of his wounds, the sacrificial nature of his death on the cross. So that when we come to communion, and when Neve and Helena come to communion, they will hear the words that they've heard before. But this time it's going to be intimately personal, distinctly said for them, as distinctly as it is said for others. The body in the blood of our Savior Jesus Christ will be given to you for the forgiveness of sins and for eternal life. And it will benefit all of us, certainly me, to meditate as deeply as possible the depth of those words and the depths of the intentions of our Heavenly Father. That because of Jesus, he could feel every one of our hurts, wounds, whatever it might be, to reflect on those little things that might be bothering you, or even the things that we have failed in our relationship with the Lord, and be reminded that God is there for us. And this power forgive and to promise and to heal and to sort through our life what are those things that we're not dealing with that cause us to be sometimes mismanaging our relationship with others, overreacting, or not acting at all, or not having empathy for the feelings of others. Those who are struggling to get through each day. All of that is found in his body and blood. The vulnerableness that he allows us to touch him with our lips and with our bodies. And now when you hear in the liturgy, you have united, O Lord, your divinity with our humanity. It's happening to you. Starting today, his divine nature is mixing with your human nature, transforming and changing as we continue to walk through this life, opening our heart to his compassion and his mercy.
Thank you.
spiritual blessings upon them, and place that they are as a gift. Grant them life in your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who please God from Adam to the present, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Mary, Saint Joseph, and Saint Jude. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for our first communicants. Remember also those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
Creation.
Send our love as we
intercessions and prayers, and grant security to your people and peace to your flock. Protect our shepherds, Francis the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter our Patriarch of Antioch, and Gregory John our Bishop. Assist the priests, the deacons, and all those who serve your holy church, so that they may intercede and pray to you on our behalf. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, those who have asked us to pray for them, those who desire but were unable to make an offering, and those who assist your holy church. Be a shelter and a refuge for them, for you are the Savior of all. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the civil leaders in our country and throughout the world. Enlighten their consciences to bring security and peace to your people. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for all those who daily struggle with chronic illness and pain in their lives, that they will find healing and comfort in the Lord. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the Holy Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, St. Joseph, St. Jude, and St. Mary, St. Charlotte, and all the saints. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy of their reward. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the righteous fathers and teachers who have gone to their rest among the saints. Remember those who diligently carry out your gospel throughout the whole world and confirm your holy church in the true faith. Assist us through their prayers and strengthen us in your love. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We give a special prayer for Helena and Abia. As the divine nature of our Lord becomes united with their humanity, as in their baptism they were made temples of the Holy Spirit, now the body and blood of our Lord will dwell within them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Favorably remember, O Lord, our prayers, brothers and sisters, teachers, and all who faithfully departed here and everywhere who have gone to the rest. Forgive us and forgive them of all sins and offenses. To our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us, O God, to the Lord, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things, through the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come.
temptation that we do not have the strength to overcome, but deliver us from every evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us bow our heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of it, and receive the blessing of the Lord.
O Lord, bless your worshipers who bow before you and implore you. Make them worthy of your mercy and forgive their sins. For your almighty and rich in compassion, we raise glory and thanks to you and to your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, the eternal and constant stand shall be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for the life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ for the first time, for the forgiveness of sins, and for eternal life.
Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, forgive us of sins, and eternal life.
time to give out the holy icon for prayers for vocations to the priesthood in the Maronite Church. May Almighty God's blessing be upon you. May you hear your prayers. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today at 3 o'clock, Eric Hoogland will be speaking the early history of the area Lebanese community at the Taconic Genealogy Library on Lithgow Street, Winslow. It's in the bulletin if you want to hear his lecture on the immigration of the Lebanese community and their impact in the Waterville, Winslow area. We thank you, O Father, for this gift that you have given us, though we are unworthy. Do not shame us because of our sins, but help and save us, that we may raise glory and thanks to you and to your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
With
Lord Jesus, stretch forth your right hand and bless your people. Protect them by your cross. Be the shelter and refuge, and perfect them with your abundant blessings, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your blessed Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Please stand.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Amen.
I
leave you in peace, O holy altar, and I hope to return to you in peace. May the offering I have received from you be the forgiveness of my faults and the remission of my sins, that I may stand without shame or fear before the throne of Christ. I do not know if I shall be able
ride with you?
I will.
With you? Good.
Both, they're both on the lawn, right? They're both on the lawn. It's a production different. So sometimes I guess there's some days on it.
You know, your class, I'm your class.
I know, yeah.
Yeah. Y'all are my love seeing. As a matter of fact, I got a good fit.
Thank you.